DevOps track, where we want to foster more contributions to GHC and to motivate more newcomers to come and join. We thought it would be good to go through the GHC newcomers guide and show people how they can contribute and hack on GHC. I'm new myself, so I've only started looking at the GHC source code when preparing for this presentation, so this is truly from a newcomer for newcomers. And we have some people in the room, I think. Maybe not. Okay. If anyone notices something that is wrong and has been working on GHC before, please tell me. So, why would you... No, we have someone in the room who knows. So why would you hack GHC in the first place? Well, for a programmer, the compiler is arguably among the most important tools, and it's good to know your tools better, and it might also help you understand the language better. If you know how the type checker works, you might better understand error messages that GHC throws at you, or if you know how the optimizer works, you might be able to write more efficient code. And it's also just cool, and if there's anything in GHC that bugs you, you can fix it. How to get started? Fortunately, there is lots of documentation out there. There is the newcomer's guide that we're going to walk through here. The wiki has lots of things, all the details about the build system. There is the GHC commentary, which is a great source for lots of complicated, deep, in-depth concepts of GHC. There is the community, and in the end, I have a few more references. Okay, so if you want to hack on GHC, what do you need to do first? Of course, you need to install some dependencies. That strongly depends on your platform, so I'm not going to show you much of that here, but there is a detailed guide. And if all else fails, there's fortunately also a Docker container that you can just use. Then the next step is to get the sources. GHC uses Git, and Haskell.org hosts a Git repository for GHC. They use lots of submodules for dependencies of GHC, so you need to make sure to also get the submodules. There is also a GitHub mirror for minor contributions. They say you can also send them through GitHub. In that case, you need to put in some extra config. There is a mismatch in the shape of the paths, but can be configured to work. As I said, GHC uses Git submodules, which the UI too can be a bit confusing. So a brief survival guide, when you pull new changes, it will only, by default, pull the top-level repository, not any of the dependencies, which might give you some weird build errors of missing types in some of the submodules, so you need to pull recursively. And also when you switch between branches, the same issue will only, by default, switch the top-level repository, so you need to update the submodules to actually get everything on the right track. So just a brief survival guide. There are lots of details about the submodules also in the GHC wiki. A brief side note, if you happen to be someone who knows about and likes Git part trees, they can be made to work with submodules. It takes a bit of a workaround. I'll make the slides available, and mostly I've just stolen it from the wiki anyway. But it's good to know. Okay, so now you have the sources and all the dependencies installed. So what do you do next? You need to configure the build, because by default, GHC build system is configured for production settings, which makes for a really nice and fast GHC, but also makes for really long and slow build times. So for development, you probably want to change the settings. And there is a sample configuration file, as shown here, that you can copy and then switch between build flavors. There are lots of examples, or lots of pre-configured build flavors in there. And the one that is recommended to get started is DevL2, which stands for Developing Stage 2. So what does that mean? GHC has different build stages. The first of them is, so in order to build GHC, you need GHC, obviously. And that first GHC that you need to have is called the Bootstrap compiler, or Stage 0. That's just the GHC you already have installed in your system when you start out. Then that one builds the dependencies and libraries and builds a version of GHC that is called stage 1. Then that's stage 1, is once more used to build libraries, the runtime system engine supports more in the Dispel stage 2. And then optionally, just as a test, you can build stage 3, which is GHC once more built, in this case from GHC stage 2, but that's not going to concern us. And I think if you do cross-compiling, you have to worry about something in those stages, but I didn't look into that much. Okay, so then once you've configured the build system, you can start with the first build, which is running boot script, which will generate the configure scripts. Then you can run the configure script, which will generate the make files. And then you can run make to build stage 1 and stage 2. And then you go fetch and ring, because that takes a while. And once you've done that, you have a nice GHC, and just to demonstrate that, it will put a GHC into in place in stage 2, and you can make it into a GHCI like this. And then you can use your self-built compiler. And I've prepared this at home because otherwise this would take too long. Okay, now once you've done that, the build system is still configured to rebuild stage 1 when you make changes, and you don't want to do that when you are just developing. So in this build configuration, you also need to switch the build mode to only build stage 2. So just to quickly what this looks like. This is this build configuration file. There are lots of build flavors pre-configured. This is the one you need to uncomment first, and then this one you need to uncomment second, and then you're ready to work. Also, when you make changes only locally in some part of GHC, it's going to be faster if you run make inside that subdirectory, because then it's going to skip some of the dependency checking. And you can also use make fast to skip even more dependency checking and want to make the build even faster. Only if you do git pull and have changes all over the code base, you should do it properly. Okay, so let's do a brief sanity check. Let's fire up GHCI and produce some error. It says variable not in scope. Can you see that down there? Or is that too low? So let's change that into something else. Okay, so it tells us where to look for this error message. So let's edit this file, and conveniently the editor is already there. So what do you want to make GHC say? Rebuild, we should go into the subdirectory where we made changes. So these changes were made in the compiler subdirectory, so we can go here, and then we want to make run make fast and use some cores. And that takes a while. And now let's run this thing again. And there we go. Clear improvement. Let's make a patch. Random hint, if you are in some subdirectory, in some of them you can type in make help, and it will give you a list of make targets that are relevant there. So in the top level, it will show you some things. Make fast, make clean, make estes, stuff like that can be useful. What I've been showing here so far is the make file based build system, which is supposed to be replaced by a new shake based build system, which is called Hadrian. Work's been ongoing for that for a bit, and hopefully it's going to be coming soon, maybe in 8.6. If you want to learn more about that, Google it, there's lots of information. And also in the Hadrian subdirectory, there's a meme which has lots of information. Okay, so let's look at the sources to get a bit of an overview what's going on in there. So at the top level, we have a bunch of files, lots of them related to the build system, like config and makefile, lots of them documentation, README, and so on. Another one, which is nice, is hacking, which has some links and information about how to get started. Might be a good place to have a look. More about the source itself. There is a directory called libraries. This might contain some familiar names like array or text or whatever. These are mostly dependencies or GHC's dependencies, and they're mostly Git submodules that are pulled in from somewhere else. So GHC really is a Haskell program that uses Haskell libraries. I think it's nice to see. Then there is the compiler subdirectory. As the name suggests, this is where most of the action happens. So this is GHC, the library. GHC is split into two parts, the library and the executable. And in here you find a Haskell library which contains most of GHC. So you find things like parser, type checker, or code generation, all that kind of stuff. And then GHC, the executable, is in the GHC subdirectory. These directories called stage 1 and 2, they are generated by the build system and otherwise in GHC you find the main files, so it's really a Haskell program the way you know it. And then there is the runtime system. As you can see, that is largely written in C. So that contains things like the memory manager or the scheduler or garbage collector, stuff like that. And docs contains the GHC manual if you want to fix something in there. And then also very important is the test suite, because it contains just that. The GHC commentary that I linked in the beginning also here is great to get a really detailed overview of everything in there. Okay, a brief overview, simplified, of the GHC compilation pipeline. First you have the source text, you parse that into some parsed representation. Then this is desugared into the Haskell core language. Then this is turned into something called the spineless tagless G machine, just an abstract machine model that GHC uses. And then this is generated, this is turned into C++, just a low-level interim representation kind of language. And then there are different backends to turn that into assembly and actually binary that can be executed by default, the native code generator, or there's also an LLVM backend. And the C backend is set to be outdated. So what do you do next when you want to get started hacking on something? You need to find something to work on. So the newcomer's guide has a list of issues you can look at. So this is what this newcomer's guide looks like. It's a part of the wiki. There's all the first steps I showed you, how to rebuild. And then there is a nice list of bugs that might be a good starting point. When you look at these, it's well worth to read through the bug tracker and make sure to look at all the comments carefully, because maybe some people have already been trimming their bug, or there is some really good information in there. So make sure to look at that. You can also sort the tickets on track by milestone, so if you want to see what's left for the next release, you can have it there. You can ask in the community. Or maybe you yourself found a bug in GHC that you want to fix. So depending on how hard it is, might also be a good starting point. Once you're there, how do you contribute? First of all, you should make sure there is a ticket on the bug tracker. Then you should also communicate that you are actually intending to work on this, to deduplicate effort, and maybe somebody has some hints or something like this. You should add a test case to make sure that what you are doing in the end actually works. Then, obviously, fix the bug. Make sure that you actually did fix the bug. And make sure to refer to the ticket number in your commits so that people can later find out what the heck you were doing. Then there's also a validation stage. So when you There is, I'm going to show you here, Fabricator, which is the code review platform. It has a kind of CI called Harbor Master, which will validate and build the tests and everything. You can also do this locally with the validate script. So Fabricator, that's a code review and automated build tool. It's a kind of web application kind of interface. You need to sign up, you can link it to your GitHub account or whatever else. Looks like this. So yeah, you can see it's a big interactive platform with a dashboard and everything. You can have a look at your work. You need to link it with an SSH key just the same way as you would do with GitHub, for example, so that from your command line you can directly push up your changes. There is a command line tool called Arcanist. Of which you should install a recent version, and then you can use that to interact directly with Fabricator from your command line. You install with this install certificates command a user token to give it permissions to log in your name, and then the command to actually submit your work is git div, arc div, and then the revision from before your set of changes. And of course, update the ticket on track to show people that you've been doing some work. Okay, so let's have a look at something I did. So when preparing for this, I was hoping that I would find a really simple issue on this list here. And very luckily, I actually did find a very simple issue on this list. Beautiful name. No, it's gone. Okay. There it is. So this was a bug that was listed in this newcomer's guide among the newcomer's issues. When you look at these that show up, you will see that at some point in the communications, somebody will have said the keyword newcomer added, and then they're automatically part of this wiki. And this particular one is about pretty printing of promoted data types. So I'm not sure if everybody knows about promoted data types. It's not really super important to understand this issue, just so you know what I'm talking about. Say you want to have something like, you know about types that can be indexed by other types, right? You can do something like this. So this type is indexed by another type, but now you might want to index a type by a value. So you might want to have like a vector which is indexed by length and then has something here. By default, you cannot do that, but you can lift values into the type level, and this is called promoted data types. And then you might have something like a type, something here, bits of type, vector of length 5. And now to tell GHC that this is a promoted type or a promoted value, you need to put this little single quote in front. And now you might want to do something more fancy than a vector, like you might want to do a matrix. So you could put two numbers in there, and maybe you want to go even fancier. And you want to have a tensor, and then you could have a list of things in here. Now you might have noticed that I put a space here. The reason for that is if you don't put a space here, then GHC thinks that this is a character literal, and this is actually syntax error. So far so good. Now the issue was that when GHC spit out error messages, it would actually spit them out in this form. So the error messages contained invalid syntax. It's not catastrophic, but it's not nice. That was the issue that was described here. And then how to fix it? Well, first, make sure to read through all the communication, because there's some useful information here. Like, for example, we're told to have a look at pretty print interface type list. If we look there, we see that this is part of the compiler of a module called interface, and in there is this type. So if we have a look at this, kindly tells us that depending on what kind of type list it receives, it either writes it with consists or it writes it in list syntax. And then if we have a look here, we find that indeed there it puts a single quote in front and then puts brackets around the next thing and then does a map of some type pretty printing over a list of types. So it looks like this is going to be the place we are going to have to do a change. Okay, so what did the list contain as steps to do? Well, first we need to add a test case. Okay. So let's first verify that this issue actually exists. So if we go to our compiler here, and then we need to activate some language extensions. And there we go. Indeed, we see here the space is missing. Okay, so the wiki contains a detailed description of how to add tests and how to work with a test suite. That's definitely worth a look when you want to add a test. But just in brief, under test suite, there you find tests. And there you find lots of directories with lots of different components. And the instructions in the wiki say that you should put your tests into a subdirectory which is related to whatever it is you're working on. Makes sense. And in this case, there is a place called printer. And in there, we find lots of Haskell source files and some output files. So what do tests in there look like? We have things like, I don't know, this one for example, which, what does this do? It uses some template Haskell, it makes sure to dump the splices, and then it does some splice, and okay, so this is supposed to compile and then spit out the code that was actually inserted here. And then we saw that matching to this 14289, there is a file called same name std out. And if we have a look at that, oops, here, we see that this is the expected output. So most of these tests and the tests we work like that. You have some code which is supposed to, in some form, generate some particular output, and then it just matches the string to see if the test passes. At least for the pretty printer, that's mostly the kind of test you find, if that makes sense. Okay, so we add our own version of a test here, and to spare you some typing, prepared something there. So I've just kind of copied the example and some more complicated ones, and yeah, this is supposed to generate error messages for the type toll, which then are supposed, my editor kindly confirms it down there, supposed to have this issue in there. So now let's actually see if this test fails. So for that we can run make test, and the test suite is big, so we don't want to run all of it now. So there is this thing to tell it to only run one particular test case. And then we see we got one unexpected failure, and that is indeed because the output expects a space here and we do not actually have a space here. So yeah, sorry, I jumped ahead. What I need to show is that this includes a file which shows or which contains the expected error messages, which are the ones with the space. And then to add a test, actually, there is this, in most of these subdirectories, this file alt-t, which has a syntax that is explained in the wiki in detail, but it's essentially like the name of the test, how you want to run it, in this case, nothing special, and then what you expect, the compilation should fail, and we don't want to pass any particular arguments, so this is how the tests are specified. And in this case, I also, I don't know if this can be automated, but I had to add them to the make file as well.
Hadrian will take care of it.
Huh?
Hadrian might take care of it.
Might. Yeah.
Because you can read all T and then go find it.
But with the simple make, it didn't.
Could you show your test case again?
Mm-hmm.
Because it seems you're not testing for the case where parentheses would be quoted, or I haven't seen that part.
Yeah, so actually this was mentioned in the issue that for tuples it's also one, and I called that the same issue but B. So there is one here. Where we are, sorry, that's a different one. Here, where we have a tuple outside and a nested, and also a tuple at the list. And the other one had a list containing a tuple as well.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, if you can think of other counterexamples.
I think for the counterexample, you need this switching over parentheses operators. I mean, I wonder whether you have a case where we could do curly braces. Maybe that's
curly braces in the type.
Not illegal.
I don't know. How do you? Is there syntax? Maybe there is some. No.
The other option might be escapes. That it looks like an escaped character literal.
Ah, so that you have a type indexed by a character literal, and then you have something escaped in there. Or?
But the other question is, why do you have two test cases? I mean, it would be as easy just to test all of these different cases in the one file.
Yeah, that's fair enough. The changes are in two different places, and I've seen in the test suite that there is a common pattern of having like issue number and then issue number B, C, D for different kind of subcases. So I thought
I
follow that style, and nobody has told me not to so far on the code review. So yeah. Okay. So now we've seen that the issue actually fails. So what do we do next? Well, we go back to the source directory, and then we have a look again. Oh, sorry. At this file. So we have to make some change here. So essentially what we want to do is we want to insert a space here conditionally if the incoming type is a promoted type, and there is also the same thing for tuples a bit further down somewhere in this file as well. Not sure if I'm going to find it now, but yeah, I think here it is. Anyway, so GHC is very big, but fortunately, at least in this case, it was actually surprisingly contained, everything. Everything that I needed to know and look at was in this file. So what we get in here is some pretty printing precedence, which will t- tell us if we should parentheses around this or not. Then we have a type 1, which is the first element of the list, and then we have another type, which is the tail of the list, and these are of type interface type. So we just have a look at what this is actually defined as, and we find there's a huge code block talking about nothing else, and we can see that in here we have a type constructor application, and if you look at this list function below, this is actually what this was looking at, and then this has the type constructor, and this type constructor has a name and has some information, and if you dig further, you see that this information fortunately contains, is this thing promoted or not? So this is just what we need to check for. And yeah, this is, I mean, a bit of a coding exercise. I'll jump ahead and show you the result. And by the way, this is still under review, so it might very well be completely wrong. so how is this called? Tiles or something. Yeah, so you can see I made a little change here. There was this brackets thing before. I insert a space if promoted. I did the same thing in the tuple, so I should actually lift this out. But what this does is it takes the interface type, it checks if it is a type constructor application, it digs out this type constructor info, checks if the thing is a promoted type constructor, and if so, it inserts a space, otherwise it does nothing. Simple.
Can you promote character literals?
I don't know.
Well,
it
can,
look
that's going to be
like
case.
A quote, a quote, or...
Perhaps you can just use them freely.
Maybe. Yeah.
I mean, or we can actually check whether this
works
in iface type, interface type on, what is the iface type?
Yeah.
I mean, there you should see whether it can represent.
So one thing that is in there is something which is called literal. So like that. And it contains num and string type literals.
Yes.
Okay. So to validate that this actually works, we compile this new version. Test. So we run that test. And an error. Oh, I'm in the wrong directory. Okay, and we get one expected passes. Great. So let's actually look at the GHCI again and type in the same example once more and see if we are satisfied. And indeed, here this looks nice. And then there was the example of a nested this looks nice here. Sadly not here. And before it actually looked nice here, and not here. I don't know why. So yeah, this is ongoing.
But the inner list looks nice in the same way.
Yeah, the inner list does look nice. So. This is, I find this very fascinating. So there seem to be different code paths going on here. Maybe some post-processing, I'm not sure. I've just done the fix last week, and so I haven't had time since to look at this particular weirdness.
What would be your expectation relative to how such a list should wrap? So, I mean, you added a space in front of an fset, which sort of indents the whole wrap. So fset,
yeah.
What it does is it takes the list, pre-prints, well, it takes a list of documents,
yeah.
And just lays them out sort of in paragraph style,
yeah.
But keeping the indent at the beginning.
Yeah.
So if you add the space in front, sort of you shift the indent, the other option would be that you would say, well, I want the list sort of to align on the first bracket.
Right, yeah, that's a good point.
It's probably just one thing to look at.
Yeah, that's definitely a good point. Yeah. I mean, well, what's funny about this particular instance is that in the line above, this particular case looks right. So, something funky is going on. But yeah, the alignment is definitely a good point. Well, it's surprising how something that looks simple can then sometimes be not so simple. Okay, so in terms of coding example, that's actually already everything. It went much faster than I thought. Then maybe the other thing I can briefly show is the interaction with this arc tool, at least at a certain point, because I don't want to mess up the bug tracker. But if you make some change, so if we, for example, go back to our initial state and we again, where was it?
What would happen if you have some special type with your custom type with the constructors with a prime at the end, and then you have some parameter value of it, and then if you promote it, then you would have this special type, this prime at the end, and space, and then again, like Boolean, for example, true with prime at the beginning.
Let's demonstrate. So, What should it look like?
I don't know, maybe prime, just prime.
Okay, so yes, and then we do just prime, maybe?
Yeah. I mean, one of the constructor would be just prime, and then parameter, anything you want.
So there should be a prime at the end of all
the
constructors.
Of constructor.
Oh, I see, I got it. Okay. So, okay, so we're going to, I don't know, make this guy, and maybe actually make him like this, and then we do this.
I didn't see it because of the light.
Can you just make the window smaller from the bottom? Just split it one pillar.
Is that better?
I think we need an argument for the value.
Yeah.
Because then the argument we can quote it again. So if that's true, for example.
Right, okay. Okay, so this guy needs an
this
argument.
This one, and at the end, no, just it's
just a bool.
For constructor. Just
oh, right.
A bool to them, yes.
And here we put this guy.
Yeah.
What's going
on? Somebody thought about this.
It's a kind, it's not a value, is it?
that's fine, it inserted two spaces.
we activated polyprimes, right?
But what if you also change foo to f prime?
Right.
Oh!
It's a very good question. So we do this. And then. Too bad.
You newcomer bug.
Yes. Cool.
Unfixable.
Huh?
And like, how do you fix it?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe you could allow this. I don't know. Yeah, that's...
Oh, it is allowed, isn't it?
Is it? Oh, it changed the...
It just parsed.
Yeah.
But it has to be pretty printed correctly again.
Yeah, that is true. That is true. Well, it's a never-ending issue. All right. Any more... otherwise, I wanted to also briefly show this arc tool. So that's this, and go back to our type arrow and say. This and it's a clear improvement. And the way you would do this is you would take type arc head, sorry, arc div head hat. So you have to put in the revision before your change. In this case, we only made one commit, so it's going to be that one. And then this is going to start up a text editor, and here you can type in a message, a summary, some people you want to look at this, related issues, and all sorts of things. And I'm not going to actually do anything here. But and then if you are in the review process and you do any further changes that are requested, then you can update by just running arcdiff, and it will upload your latest changes. And then the Fabricator platform is a platform where you can look at code diffs, and discuss on the line comments and everything. It's not the same as maybe GitHub, but I mean, it's fairly easy to get into. So.
There are some comments though. So if you rebase your changes,
Then
you do RPG.
Oh, that breaks?
It's just going to output to your differential all the changes that were, that included the rebase. So I would recommend doing that.
Okay, didn't know that. So don't rebase.
Or rebase and then do something like arcdiff origin master.
To make it
you set the kind of baseline what you want to do.
Right, but can you then tell it to refer still to the same?
Okay. It's going to automatically update the right differential.
So does it do that by branch name, or how does it do that?
I think it's on something. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, that's good to know.
You can also not easily work with multiple commits in a series. So many people just squash their commits, which is of course ugly. But if you try to actually upload multiple commits, it's possible. So you would have, if you make, let's say in your branch you make like 10 commits, you can make it such that each commit is a separate entry in Fabricator. Can you go back to the Fabricator page? And then if you scroll all the way up, you can on the right side, there's this related revisions things where you can say what's, so if you have a series of commits, you would typically, or I think it can also set for you the set of parents. So you would have each is the parent of the other one. So that part is fine, but it would be split across multiple diffs, and you would have to make sure that these parent revisions are set correctly. Also, what you cannot do is then you get some feedback on the patch in the middle, basically. Then you change that patch, so of course with Git that's very easy. But afterwards, if you then want to update the corresponding diff in Fabricator, you have to manually like go to that commit and put the right number in to update, like V4746, for example. And if you have a longer series of commits, that can be extremely annoying. If you put the wrong number, one of the 10, then chaos ensues. So for simple changes, keep it for to one, it makes it a little bit easier.
I have bottom line is going to hop.
But maybe we can write some tooling so it can do that automatically, because it technically has all the information necessary.
Yeah.
This is the tool that Facebook uses internally, is it? Or?
Yes. Like all good Haskell tooling, this PHP tool is applied also for GHC.
Yes.
Maybe one more thing to say, which is that if you have a super easy patch and you expect that it's so trivial that you probably don't even have to discuss it there, you can also just make a pull request on GitHub and ping one of the IRC guys to say, hey, look, I made that there, can you pull that? Like on GitHub or anywhere else, really. You just show them your commit and then they will do that for you.
I think also just go ahead and GitHub, you don't necessarily need to pay them.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe one thing I can also talk about with regards to the test suite. So after we made this change with the formatting in error messages, you might expect that maybe this also affects other error messages, so this might actually break other test cases. But it sort of breaks them in a way which is kind of like it's something where the test case should be fixed, right? And going having to go through all this manually would be extremely annoying. So fortunately, there is a way to just say make, accept, and then if you do it like this, it's going to run all tests, and any of those which fail, it's just going to say, well, the failure was obviously right, so it's going to replace the expected outcome. You can also give it a list of like the different test cases you wanted to check. Then it's only going to run those tests, and those that fail, it's going to replace the expected, like the test name dot std error or out or whatever, with the actual outcome.
Which you can then diff easily.
Yeah, of course, you can then diff this easily, so it doesn't cause havoc. It's still a fun thing. And I'm doing this on NixOS, which sometimes confuses systems a little bit. So when I did a make test, I had a bunch of failures, and then it's actually an easy way to see which ones fail. So you can actually do a make accept, and that all the tests that fail just put into a diff what went wrong, and then you can have a nice git diff of all the test failures, and then you see lots of like, I don't know, slash bin ls not found, because why is it not there? And stuff like that. Okay.
Are you planning to adapt the test suite? That it works on Nix, or are you pressing stops in the right place?
I mean, yeah, that would be a fairly easy fix, so those slash bin, slash ls kinds of things. I think there's even an issue somewhere on track about that, which was fixed at some point, and then probably there are not enough people regularly doing this on Nix. And I mean, also the, so, Nix, of course, has a bunch of GHC packages, and they have a patch phase in there. So if you just want to build GHC, then you can just go to Nix and run the patch phase, and it will fix all these things. We'll just make a really messy git diff. Okay. Yeah, any further questions? Or any great things that people actually know about? Can you just see one to share? Yeah?
What's the stage with the compiler version, and how often is it updated?
I'm sorry?
What's the stage?
just stage one compiler version.
Yeah, so the first stage that's used to build.
Or you mean stage zero?
Oh, stage zero.
Right, right. So that's just the system compiler that whatever you come with.
Well, but that's not quite true, right? I mean,
right.
I think that the general policy is that GHC patch should be built with at least the last two official releases of GHC.
Oh, okay.
Right. So you know, today you might not be able to build GHC patch with something like 7.6.
Yeah, but is this that you should use one of those, or is it that GHC should support the last two?
I think that essentially, if you want to use new feature in GHC source code,
yeah,
then you need to make sure that at least the last two releases will compile it correctly.
Right. Okay. So in this particular instance, I'm using 8.2. And I mean, that's where NixOS is kind of nice. So I can just say, take Haskell compiler GHC head, and yeah, take its inputs and make that into a Nix shell, and then I have whatever GHC needs.
Yeah, that being said, I'm actually not sure if this policy is still applicable because GHC is not moving towards a bit more rapid release process, like
right.
Every half year or something. So that also might change slightly. I'm not sure.
Okay, so then that reduce the number of versions that it needs.
I mean, I think that essentially they're moving from a year, you know, one release per year cadence to two releases per year.
Hmm.
And actually, the GHC DevOps or the GHC DevOps initiative is exactly about supporting that.
Yeah.
Just making sure that the compiler authors can mostly focus on changing the compiler instead of getting the fluff around correct.
Yeah.
Keeping the system working. System hosting CI and testing and validation. Performance regressions.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks a lot, Andreas.
Yeah.
Very helpful.
Have you already advertised the GHC beginners track?
The DevOps track, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, once more, if you're joining ZuriHack, make sure to have a look at the GHC DevOps track. We'll have Manuel Chavarki for sure. He's going to talk about CI. Then you said you'd do something. And I don't know, what's the state of the rest?
So we need to discuss later again, but also if you just want to pick up any beginner's bug and you want to have Andreas watch over you that you're doing it correctly, then you can sit on our table and we'll do it together.
And we have a number of people who volunteer to mentor, so there's going to be a bunch of people around who are experienced and can help you. And if you want to participate on the website, there is a link to a poll. Make sure to fill out the poll. It helps us to keep track of how many people are going to join and who's going to mentor and stuff like that.
But at the location, it's actually really simple. It's just one of the classrooms we have. There's the GHC DevOps people in there. People do that project. There's also going to be, again, announcement sort of an opening ceremony. So it's really easy to go there if you want to.
Yes. And also, if you didn't poll or anything, and when you're there, you feel like joining, just join. That's fine.
Yes, exactly.
And for special motivation, if the beginner's bugs are all too difficult, if you add one that makes that when I type import, I can tap complete the import, then the next pizza is on me. And of course,
hello, internet. Have you heard that?
Oh.